Hello. As you've seen in the previous video, automating virtual environments has its own set of challenges. So, in this episode, we'll cover a few tips and tricks and good practices. We'll focus mainly on keyboard actions because they tend to be faster and more reliable than click image and similar actions. An often overlooked issue with image-based automation is knowing when to perform certain actions, also known as waiting for a specific state. Whether you're waiting for an application or web page to load, or waiting for a certain process to end, most of the time you'll need to know the state of your application so you can perform further actions. The solution for that is actually quite simple, and it involves imagining how a human would evaluate the state of a certain app and mimic that. Let's say we'd like to automate going to the SAP homepage and logging in by clicking this button. On a desktop, you wouldn't have any issues. Just record your actions, and that would be it. The UiPath actions themselves are smart enough to wait for each element to load before interacting with it. But on a virtual machine, it's a different situation. All we have is an image and no direct access to individual elements or their state. So we'll look for visual elements that tell us the page or app is done loading or ready. You could wait for a specific element on a page, like a picture or button, but a better and more general solution would be to wait for the loading icon to disappear and be replaced with the fav icon. Each site has its own little logo or graphic. For that, we have the handy FindImage activity. So let's quickly make a new sequence and try it out. We'll add the FindImage action. And indicate the image you would like to detect by dragging a selection marquee like so. And that is actually all there is to it. Find image stops the execution process until that specific image is found or the timeout is reached, whichever comes first. Now, let's add a message box to be notified when the image is found. And before we run the workflow, let's leave the SAP page so we can clearly see the find image in action. So run, and that's earlier than expected. Maybe it somehow got confused. Let's try to find the problem. We'll add a highlight action to see what was detected. For that, we'll create an output variable for the find image action. It will give us the element that was found. We can highlight a clipping region, an element, or a selector. We'll just use here the element generated by the find image action. And we'll change the color to red and the time to 2 seconds for better visibility. Now, let's see where the problem is. Well, don't I feel silly? Didn't even notice it there. Let's remove this and try again. Okay, looks like this time we're in the clear. So let's go to the SAP page. Here's the loading indicator. And when the page loads, the highlight appears for 2 seconds and the message box is displayed. So there was nothing wrong with it after all. This means we can delete this message box, but we'll leave the highlight for now in case we need it later. So from here on, it's familiar territory. Add a click image to open the login window and indicate the button and run. Right, looks like it's working. Normally, you could use click relative for the text fields and another click image for the button, but using keyboard navigation is faster and a bit more reliable. Which brings us to the next section, automating virtual machines with keyboard commands. Carrying on with our example, we notice we're pretty lucky because the focus is already on the first input field. So all we have to do is type the email and press tab once to go to the next field. Here we can type the password and then we can press tab once, twice, and the third time we're on the logon button. So with that information, we can start automating. We'll add a type action after it and use it to type in the two fields and navigate between them. First, we'll create two variables to hold the email address and the password, and we'll give them some initial values for testing. It's Since the email field already has focus, we'll start with email, then tab to go to the next field, then password, then three tabs because we want to reach the login button, and add an enter to activate it. And that should be fine. So let's see. Nothing happens while on this empty page, but when we go to the SAP homepage, the find image is triggered, and the rest of the workflow follows. It was pretty fast, but apparently it worked. Obviously, it couldn't log on with this test user, but you get the idea. You might notice that sometimes the type command fails. It might be because the login window doesn't have enough time to open. An example of bad practice in solving this would be to add a delay between the click and type action to give the window some time to open. It's a bad solution because the modal window might take longer than the delay you set, and most of the time less. Either way, it's not optimal because you'll have to cover the worst case scenario, so you'll end up with a long delay that needlessly slows down your workflow. The optimal solution would be to add a new find image to wait for that window to load. I'll let you do that yourself. Okay, next up, starting apps. Starting apps is pretty trivial, even on virtual machines, but we'll look at a few methods, from the simplest to the most demanding situation. The first and most obvious one is double-clicking a desktop icon. You can use a regular click image action to perform a double-click on a certain icon. Just change the click type from a single to a double-click. The problem with this method is that it can be a bit fragile if you're not careful. For example, even selecting the icon can make it break down, if the selection was not precise enough. As you can see, it can't find and click the icon because it's not selected, so it has a different background. But that can be easily fixed by making a better image selection, one that doesn't include any portion of the background, because that is what was different when the icon was selected. Another better method of opening an app is by assigning it to a Windows shortcut key. You can use any shortcut you like, but it's safer to use more complex ones as it'll be less likely to interfere with existing ones. Now, once a shortcut key is set, simply add a send hotkey action to your workflow and assign it to the correct combination. And of course, indicate the window where to send the hotkey. In our case, the virtual machine window. And when we run, we see the application starting up flawlessly. This should probably be your first choice for starting apps, as it's fast, reliable, and super easy to implement. And the third method is for special cases where you need to run apps with parameters or arguments. For example, let's say you wanted to open various text files with this Notepad app that we've been playing around with. How would you start the Notepad app itself? One way of doing it is to use the Windows Run command and paste the application's path that we can get from its shortcut. So, we'll copy this file path and press the Windows key and R, the shortcut for the Run command. Well, it looks like it's actually triggered my system's run utility instead of the virtual machine's run. Now, that's not very helpful. Maybe you could avoid that by using the remote desktop app to send special commands. But it looks like this version can only send a start menu command. That is very useful too, since we can type cmd and have a command prompt from where to start our app or use other low-level commands. Those are all fine, and very similar to the method that I'm about to show you, so make sure you try them out if they're more suitable for your situation. But for now, let's come back to opening the Notepad app and passing it some parameters, or arguments. If your remote desktop application, like mine here, doesn't support sending special shortcuts like Windows R, you should be able to send the special key when the window is in full screen. You can tell it belongs to the virtual machine from this gorgeous color scheme. So, let's quickly see how to do all that in UiPath. Starting with an empty sequence, add in a click action for the maximize button. and a send hotkey action for the win R shortcut. Let's see if that worked. Cool. Next, let's type the command to open a certain file with the Notepad app. We'll make two variables, one called app to hold the path for the application we want to open, and the other called arguments for the file and arguments we may use. For the app initial value, we'll just paste the Notepad path we copied earlier. And for the file, we'll just put a dummy path. In the type action, we'll build the string to be typed in the run utility. So, app plus a space plus arguments and an enter key at the end to run it all. Not bad. It opened our test file successfully, and that's all there is to it. If you need to, you can add another click action to exit from full screen. And this brings us to the end of the episode. I hope you now have a better understanding of how to tackle more advanced issues in virtual environments, using FindImage to wait for a specific state of an application and performing various tasks like navigating text fields and starting apps using almost exclusively keyboard actions. I'll see you for the next video. Goodbye.